our prayer request, John, I think we need to remember the people out there. I don't know if you've been tracking the weather, but they've had temperature up in the 110s, 120s. I think at one place in British Columbia, it actually got over 130 degrees,
whoa,
which is really hot because that part of the country is along the Pacific Ocean, usually cool, very moderate. So there are a lot of people that would be very thankful for the rain that we're getting. Good to see everyone. We're going to have a short devotion, and we're going to take some prayer requests. And I guess at the end, we'll decide whether we're going to break into individual groups and pray, or just let people stand and praise the Lord leading. As we grow up, we hear a lot of different praises. Would anyone like to share a praise or something that they've heard that's stuck with them? I'll give you an example. A phrase you don't hear very often anymore is someone being the apple of someone's eye. Now, what does that mean? The apple of my eye.
Number one in my life.
Okay. It means that person has a special place as far as being loved, being precious, being valuable. Have you ever wondered where some of those phrases came from? You'd be surprised when they came from the Bible. That phrase I mentioned, the apple of one's eye, that's from the Bible. It's not in the Psalms, I think, one other place. And the psalmist was using to describe how precious Israel was to God. That Israel literally was the apple of God's eye. Now lately, there's a phrase that we've all heard, and actually I'm not sure if we're getting tired of hearing it or not, but it's that word comfort zone.
Yeah.
I'm going to back up. You had your hand up. Did you want to share a phrase?
Yeah, what's good for the goose is good for the gander.
Okay. Well, you know, it would be like if someone says something, they're judging somebody else, and somebody says, that's like what the pot calling the kettle black, or something like that. Okay. Well, back to the phrase comfort zone. Any idea where that came from?
Probably the Bible.
No, it didn't come from the Bible. I looked it up. Believe it or not, it was a phrase. It was a person that originated it, and it was a specific time. It was first used by a business management analyst, and her name was Judith Barwick. And she wrote a book in 1991 called Danger in the Comfort Zone. And this is how she described the comfort zone. The comfort zone is a behavioral state within which a person operates in an anxiety-neutral condition using a limited set of behaviors to deliver a steady level of performance, usually without a sense of risk. So what does that tell you when you get past all that? Basically, it's a person who is living in a situation where there's very little stress, very little anxiety, very little worry, but basically they're doing what? They're doing the same thing over and over again. And what do you call that besides your comfort zone? You ever heard the phrase being in a rut? That's what you're doing. You're doing the same thing over and over again. And she went on to say that when you're in your comfort zone, that as far as creativity and excitement and growing and doing new things, it's very difficult because you're used to doing the same things over and over again. Have you ever just made you think, why do we look forward to a vacation?
To get out of your comfort zone?
Well, a vacation is what? Literally is going outside of your comfort zone. You're going to a new place, you're going to meet new people, and you're probably going to do new things. So in a sense, a vacation, that's really what it is. It's like stepping outside of your everyday routine of doing the same old stuff every single day. And that's why we look forward to a vacation. So I'd like to share another quote about our comfort zone. And this person said, the only thing that is stopping you from where you are to where you want to go is your comfort zone. Whenever you feel uncomfortable, instead of retreating back into your old comfort zone, pat yourself on the back and say, I must keep growing and continue moving forward. This made me think of a chipmunk. Anybody here ever watched chipmunks?
I do.
My wife was obsessed with the chipmunks in our yard. She swears they're going to chew the house down.
I love that. You should see them down there.
But you know, chipmunks are what? About this long? Maybe you put the tail or this long? But chipmunks come out of their burrow, or wherever they live, and they move away. And as soon as the chipmunk feels threatened, what does he do? He is back in that hole. Aren't we like that when we get out of our comfort zone? First little bit of stress, first little bit of worry, first little bit of fear, and we are right back into it. Now, last month, Warren Haynes was here. And on a Saturday morning, he met with some people in the church. And he was talking about communication. And I wish he could have been there. It was probably one of the best talks I have heard. He only gave us the skim off the top. I think he could have talked all day on it. But one of the things he said was, he says, we shouldn't just want to step outside of our comfort zone, because when you step outside of your comfort zone, if you're just out there for a little while and then you come back, you really haven't done anything worthwhile. He said what we need to do is expand our comfort zone. And one of the things he said was that Jesus was an example of that. And so I got to thinking about that. You know, how was Jesus an example of someone not just stepping outside of their comfort zone, but expanding it? And so I looked up some passages in the Bible. I'd like to share these with you. And I got to thinking, Jesus really showed three ways that we can expand our comfort zone. He went to new places, he met new people, and he did new things. Think about those three things. If you think about going to someplace entirely new, and think about meeting new people in different situations and doing new things, what are the first thoughts that come into your mind? Are you just chomping at the bit and raring to go? Or are you kind of saying, well, I don't really know what's going to happen?
Right.
We all tend to be a little timid and a little fearful. I think we all know where Jesus grew up. What town did Jesus grow up in?
Nazareth.
What do we know about Nazareth?
It was a small town.
Small. It was smaller than small.
No good thing comes out of Nazareth.
No, that was one of them. I think, what, did Daniel say that?
Daniel.
So anyway, I looked up Nazareth when Jesus was living, and I got a range in population from 150 people to maybe as high as 400. So we'll split the difference and say that there was maybe 275 people in Nazareth. Now, if you've ever lived in a small town or know very much about a small town, what are some things you can say about a small town?
Everybody knows everybody.
There's no such thing as a secret in a small town. When I grew up in Tennessee, there were towns that didn't even have a stoplight, didn't even have a blinking light. You had a gas station and a general store, which was a hardware store, and a farm supply store, and basically that was maybe a barber shop. So Jesus grew up in Nazareth. Was Jesus comfortable in Nazareth? Probably. He knew everybody. Everybody knew him. What would have happened if Jesus had never left Nazareth?
He never would have been the person he is now.
Right. What kind of ministry would he have had? Very limited. Nobody would have went to Nazareth, because like Robert said, what good thing ever came out of Nazareth? So in order for Jesus to do what he needed to do, which was to be our Savior, he had to move outside of his comfort zone. In the book of John, I'm in Luke chapter 2. And this is
First fruits.
The first fruits. And so every year, Mary and Joseph went up to Jerusalem, and they took Jesus with them. And it says, and when he was 12 years old, they went up to Jerusalem according to the custom of the feast. Was there anything significant about Jesus being 12 years old? Did anything happen at age 12 for a Jewish boy?
Becoming of age.
That was the coming of age. And I thought about that. I'm glad it's not that way today. Can you imagine 12 years old driving and boating and doing stuff like that? Bad enough driving. So Jesus was actually at this time considered to be a man. And it says they went up to Jerusalem according to the custom of the feast and fulfilling the day as they returned. The boy Jesus stayed in Jerusalem. Now think about this. He's 12 years old. He comes from Nazareth, which was 250 people. He's in Jerusalem. Now Jerusalem at this time had a normal population of 55,000 people. But when one of the big holy feasts was taking place, there could be as many as 200,000 people in Jerusalem. So here Jesus is there, and he decides that he's going to stay behind. And he's in this big city by himself. Don't know where he stayed. Really don't know. There's a lot about this we really don't know. And at this time, many times when people travel to Jerusalem, particularly from a village, the people from the village would travel together like a caravan. And Mary and Joseph initially didn't see Jesus, and they just figured, well, he's with some of our other friends in the caravan. So finally, after a couple of days, they noticed they couldn't find Jesus, and being obvious parents, they were worried, and they got back to Jerusalem as quick as they could, and it says in verse 46, and it happened that after 3 days, they found him in the temple. Can you imagine how frantic and worried Mary and Joseph were for 3+ days? What was Jesus doing? He says they found him in the temple, sitting in the midst of the teachers, both hearing them and questioning them. So here you have a 12-year-old boy. He's in the temple. He's with some of the most educated Jewish people. And he's talking to them, answering questions. Not only that, he's answering their questions in ways that they had never heard before, with wisdom they had never heard. So what did Jesus do at this time? Well, he went to a new place, definitely way out of his comfort zone. Now, Jerusalem was probably about, I think, 70 or 80 miles from Nazareth, due south. And so they had to travel there, and they had to travel back. And he went to Jerusalem. He also went to the temple. Now, the temple in Jerusalem, compared to the synagogue in Nazareth, was big difference. I mean, the temple in Jerusalem was the holiest place to the Jewish people. In fact, the city of Jerusalem was their holiest place. When the Jewish men, when they bowed and prayed every day, they would always be facing Jerusalem. Wherever they were. So he went to Jerusalem. He was in the temple. He met new people, these teachers. And then he did something new. He was actually talking and sharing knowledge with them. So he did this when he was 12 years old. Now this was important because every year after that, Jesus probably came back to Jerusalem for the feast. So what was he doing? He was preparing himself for what was going to happen 18 years later when he formally started his public ministry. Now, most scholars believe that Jesus was around 30 years old when he started his ministry. So he had been coming to Jerusalem. He had been consistently moving outside of his comfort zone and doing that, preparing himself for that.
Kind of like preparing the way for his new ministry.
Mm-hmm. So what else did Jesus do to broaden his comfort zone? Being a Jewish man, he was brought up and he was trained that there were certain things that Jews did not do. There was a certain group of people that lived right in the midst of them that they had nothing to do with. Anyone want to take a guess at who these people were?
Samaritans.
Now, believe it or not, Jesus grew up in Nazareth, which is in the northern area. place that he was taught he shouldn't go. Because the Samaritans were polluted people, and he was to have nothing to do with them. Now, verse 7 says, a woman of Samaria came to draw water. Jesus said to her, give me a drink. This was also something that was against what he was taught, because typically the Jewish man really had very little contact or did anything with a strange woman, much less a Samaritan woman. And the woman herself in verse 9 says, then the woman of Samaria said to him, how do you, being a Jew, ask a drink of me, who am a woman of Samaria? For the Jews do not associate with Samaritans. I mean, even the woman recognized, one, he was a Jew, and two, he was doing something that she had probably never experienced before. A Jewish man actually coming into Samaria and actually talking to her, a Samaritan woman. And so he was talking with and meeting with a new person. Now we know what the result of this was. But what else did Jesus do at this time? Verse 25, and this was, Jesus was talking to the Samaritan woman and told her that he could give her the living water that would never need to be replenished, and told her that the Jews knew what they worshiped, that God is a spirit and must be worshiped as a spirit. And then the woman says, was talking about that she knew that there was a Messiah that was prophesied to come. But verse 25 says, the woman said to him, I know that Messiah is coming. He was called Christ. When he has come, he will tell us all things. Now verse 26, Jesus said to her, I am the one, or I am the Messiah speaking to you.
Yeah.
As far as we know, this is the first time that Jesus publicly said, I am the Messiah. And his apostles, I mean his disciples, had felt that he was, and I'm sure they had told other people that the man that they were with, Jesus, was the Messiah. But biblically, this is the first time that Jesus just came out and told someone that he was the Messiah, and it was to this lowly Samaritan woman. And so Jesus went to a new place, he met a new person, and he did new things because he was willing to step outside of his comfort zone. Now the last passage I'm going to look at is in Matthew chapter 9, and this is verse 35.
Matthew 9,
verse 35. And we've looked at how Jesus went to Jerusalem. We looked at how he went to Samaria. So now we're going to see what he did in taking up really, this is where he was involved in so much of his ministry. Matthew 9:35. And Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues and preaching the gospel of the kingdom and healing every sickness and every disease among the people. Jesus came from a small town. He was very comfortable with Nazareth and the people there. But this tells us he went to many other cities and villages. And when he started out, maybe he had a little bit of anxiety. Because every time you walk into a new place, when you walk into a small village or a small town, what does everyone know immediately?
You're not a regular.
Right, you're a stranger.
Yeah.
They don't know you. Maybe they have a little fear about you. Maybe they're nosy. That seems to be one of our characteristics. So Jesus didn't really know what his reception was going to be. But he went to all of these towns and villages, and I believe he gave every one of them the same consideration where he went. And what did he do? He taught in the synagogue, and he preached the gospel. So he went to all these new places. We don't see where he rejected any or left any out. And this took months and months for him to do this. And I got to thinking about this. I believe that when he started his ministry and he started going to these villages and towns, I believe the word went out ahead of him. And I believe that when he left one village and went to another village, I believe that after a period of time, these people were waiting for him. And they had heard about him. And they had heard about his teaching. And they heard about his miracles. And so he went to these places. sickness like that and have Jesus come in and just miraculously heal you.
Like somebody who
talk
could.
Talk about making a change in someone's life.
Like if they had a relative that couldn't walk, mm-hmm. and they all of a sudden God healed them and they were able to walk. Somebody mm-hmm. in the town they knew couldn't walk. Mm-hmm.
So we see that because Jesus was willing to expand his comfort zone, he was able to accomplish in every way the purpose that God had for him. But in order to do that, he had to be willing to step out of that comfort zone. And there's other examples that you need, that you can use. Jesus was willing to touch lepers.
Yeah.
And lepers were considered to be the people in Jewish society that you stayed as far away from as you could. In fact, they were supposed to, when they were out of public, they were supposed to yell, not yell, but shout, you know. Let people know that they were unclean and not supposed to have contact with them. So after thinking about this, what are some things that we can do to step outside of our comfort zone? Well, okay, Warren.
We can invite people to church.
Well, we can do that. More importantly, we can come to church ourselves. But what can we do? Well, go to some place that you normally don't go to. You know, when we think of stepping out or expanding our comfort zone, you know, chances are we're not going to be called missionaries to go to Africa. But there are places we can go locally. For example, visiting a hospital, visiting an nursing home, visiting someone's home. Before I became a nurse, I spent in a shining hospital. Anybody in here go to a hospital just to go to a hospital? No, you don't. Anybody here go to a funeral home just to be getting out? But there are people that lose loved ones and are viewing their funeral homes and even go to.
You believe that somebody I know, I'll go to the viewing.
You know, Becky's mom, Anna Gamm, had great simple advice for visiting. She said, you pop in and you pop out.
Drop in and drop out.
Drop in, drop out. I mean, when you visit, it's not like you're going to camp out there for 2 or 3 or 4 hours. You go there and you visit. And you will, over time, you will know when to leave. But every time you do it, it gets easier, you get more comfortable. And one of the things that has amazed me more than once, and Pastor Mitch and Jay can probably agree with this, you will be amazed at how many times you go visit somebody and they cheer you up and encourage you. They are a blessing to you. Instead of you going there and you know, I'm going to be a blessing to this person, they are a blessing to you.
Yeah.
And so that is something that we can all do, is something that simple. What is another thing that we can do?
Right.
I'm going to sum it up in one word. Volunteer.
Yeah.
There are always needs within the church. If you hear of something new, something coming in the church, and there's a call that goes out for a volunteer, don't worry if you have zero experience doing it. Don't worry if you think you're too busy and can't fit in your schedule. Sign up for it.
Like the missionary. People with these missionaries coming, they need food.
Mm-hmm.
Just because you can't cook doesn't mean you can't buy a sandwich for them or whatever.
So when you volunteer, you're over time, you're expanding that comfort zone. You're going to learn something new. You're going to meet people in different situations. And you're going to meet a need, a very real need that needs to be filled. Right now, it looks like the end of August, and we're going to be starting up our small group Sunday school. Is that right, Nancy Gray?
Yes, sir.
Okay. There will be need for substitute teachers, backup teachers. Within the classes, there will be different positions. There will be different. Like with the group coming up from Kentucky, and we're providing breakfast and the evening meal for them. That's a need. Volunteer for that, to do one meal or two meals. You can never
joining in the church and doing stuff, and some of the stuff, I was like, oh, way to go, you know, so it's been a blessing to me to see how they've grown in the church and starting to help out and do stuff.
Yeah. Anyone have any thoughts to share on that?
Yeah, I'll just share a quick story that kind of fits in with this. You know, I had been praying. You know, I went up early on in my ministry here and got to know some of our neighbors right down the street here at the church. And one of the ones that piqued my interest the most, you know, was Rachel, that Shane's older sister. And, you know, Shane had come to church, but Rachel would never come to church with him. And, you know, it just always struck me as a little bit odd. She was always very cordial, but a little bit standoffish. And I think that was the experience of others that had been over there too. And anyway, ever since that point, I had been praying that God would give me an opportunity to be a blessing to that family. And recently, a few weeks back, I got the chance to go over to their house. Warren was in town, and I wanted him to meet Shane, because Shane's a fun guy, you know? I'm like, Warren, you gotta meet this guy. He's like 16 years old, going on like 90, you know? And so we go over there. Well, Shane had said he would be home, but he wasn't home. And so we pull up to the yard, and there's Rachel, you know, picking up these rocks and throwing them in a bucket. So I'm like, Rachel, what's going on? What are you up to? And she said, well, you know, Shane ditched me. I started this landscaping project, and now I'm stuck having to pull all these rocks out of the dirt before I could plant anything new here. She's like, I really should have hired a nun. This is overwhelming, you know? And so anyway, I look at Warren, and I'm like, you know what? Warren's just going to have to be along for the ride, you know? And so I said, well, we'll help you. Mind you, Warren's in his, like, suit jacket and pants. And so anyway, he's a good sport about it. And so he grabs a rake, and he starts raking the rocks. And then I kneel down in the dirt with her and start to pick up rocks and throw them in these buckets. And, you know, it was one of those moments where I had to expand that comfort zone, you know. It wasn't necessarily something that I was looking to do, but it presented itself as an opportunity. And I'll tell you what, it was a breakthrough moment doing that, because at the end of it, you know, Dave comes around front, her husband, and I said, hey, can I pray for your family? And this is the first time that she opened up that door to be able to pray for the family. And so there we stood in their front lawn, and we prayed for God's comfort, you know, for his provision, for his protection. And it was just a powerful moment. And she made the comment. She said, you know, I was so overwhelmed before you guys came and helped. And I said, you know, Rachel, I said, God knew you needed this help. And so he sent us, mm-hmm. you know. And it was just a moment to plant that seed, you know, in her mind. And, you know, obviously she's probably not a believer as of right now, but there's no doubt in my mind that we planted a seed that day, you know. And I just trust the Lord that one day we're going to see Shane sitting next to his older sister and her husband one day in church. Mm-hmm. But all that to say, it took a little bit of getting out of the comfort zone to be able to have that opportunity to be a blessing to that family.
You know, Jesus, you know, before Jesus went up in heaven, he told his disciples that he witnesses to him where? Jerusalem,
Judea,
Samaria, and to the uttermost ends of the world. I mean, that cannot happen without everyone staying in their comfort zone.
That's right.
I think of Philip and the Ethiopian eunuch. What if Philip had said, no, I want to get out of my comfort zone? What would have happened to the Ethiopian eunuch? He may have never had the experience of Christ. He may have never heard the gospel and accepted Christ as his Savior and taken the gospel back to Ethiopia. Okay. Any other comments?
And yesterday, we meet from 9 to 11 at the courthouse and pray for people. And it, every day from Saturday on, it said it was supposed to rain. Well, yesterday, this was God's doing. From 9 to 11:17, it had not rained. While we were there, three different people got saved.
Wow.
One was a Jehovah's Witness, one was just a guy that only goes to his church on holidays, and the other was a 21-year-old girl, and it was the first day of her last day of probation.
Wow.
And she got saved, and I was like, and that was God. And God knew that people needed prayer, and those people needed to be on his roll. It's amazing how God works.
Yeah.
Like, it was supposed to rain, and then from 9 till after we were done, it was dry.
Wow.
Okay, thank you everyone for your participation. For our prayer tonight, Lewis, you want to say
something? I was learning somewhere how God had people at a certain setting. He had people there witnessing, and it might have been on the radio I heard about it, but they said that people stood up for God and was willing to die for Jesus. You know how the Bible says, pick up your cross and follow him? You know what? If you stand for what's right, it may be a big cost, but you'll get a big reward in heaven.
Well, stop and think about it. If Martin Luther had ever left this comfort zone, what would happen with the Protestant Reformation?
You wouldn't have had the Bible.
If the Pilgrims had never left their comfort zone, they would have never left England and come to this country.
Yeah.
You know, this Sunday is the 4th of God to celebrate the independence of our nation. There were a group of men that met in Philadelphia and signed a piece of paper that was the birth of our country. What if they had never left their comfort zone? Would they have put their signature on that piece of paper, which literally was saying, we are breaking our ties with you, the King of England, who was the most powerful person in the world at that time? But there's so many things in history that happened, not only within the church, but really, we start to think about it, of all the martyrs that have died for their faith, if they had been.